I wanted to add to part something to your other question, because it was something that was extremely delightful to me as their colleague. And you asked about how Ben acquired the did the stuff on screen, and that really was required, lighting fire in a very wet material, wet woods, cutting. They both, you know, use these knives with proficiency, and most of the time they weren't dull, for real. And I want to say that both these actors responded very strongly to an outdoor skills instructor and expert, and they really immersed themselves, and they went in. And, you know, some of that dirt we augmented, but most of that, a lot of that dirt and on his hands and on his nails, he earned, he did it, he dug in. And that was something that was super rich for me as a director, and for the photographer, for the cinematographer, Michael McDonough. And, you know, that's one of those, you can't put that on a checklist when you interview someone. You know, how dirty are you willing to get your hands? But then when you work with people that will light that fire and blow in that tinder until it lights each time, in every setting, each location, that's why some of us love to look at things on screen, you know, that kind of process with all that texture. So, just a good question.
A great proposition. I think my question is probably for all three of you. I was wondering, what space you left during the shoot for Ben and Tom to make propositions, or, you know, how much of it was actually already there and how much evolved during the shoot? Obviously, quite a small crew, I expect.
Dans l'écriture,
I think Deb is a really amazing collaborator, and she's really generous with taking in new ideas and working with them. Obviously we followed the script, but there was also a lot of improvisation, and on some days there'd just be little things that came up out of the blue and scenes that were really genuine and quite beautiful, which added a lot to the film. But yeah, it was an amazing collaboration between everyone in the cast and crew.
On a formé une belle équipe, des bras très ouvertes aux nouvelles idées. Donc évidemment, je suivais quand même le scénario, mais quelquefois, il y avait des choses qui, sur le moment, nous venaient et qu'on nous proposait, et donc on a pu effectivement avoir un petit espace d'improvisation.
And also, there was like, within those little moments of conversation, or just little looks, or smiles, or whatever, that just happened to be caught on camera. Again, a really beautiful.
Yeah, thank you. Ben,
to that, just because Ben and Tom did a rehearsal, I think it was a day much like today. It was raining kind of on and off, and then they let, or we asked if we could, Michael and I, the DP and I, could come. Do you remember this day before we shot? And so they were already establishing a little bit of protocol in the camp. And they were working out what kind of fire pit would work, right? You were doing that with Nicole and Alan. And they were building their world a lot. So the collaboration, you know, is just really pinning it to that. And I agree that they were also establishing something before we entered the scene to actually start to film. And that's a credit to, again, I think immersing and wanting to feel maybe comfortable in their homestead, you know.
We did this beautiful film. I myself used to, I'm very sensitive to this kind of description of a community, because I used to live, I'm a director who used to live in a community myself, and one of my films was shown 50 years ago here at the Directors Fortnight. So my question was, do such communities still exist in the US, and where? About those communities, or small groups of people, or just individuals still living on their own, does that still exist in the US, and where?
In terms of people living really far off, really far, but we call it off the grid, right, and people sometimes call it undetected, anthropologically or sociologically, that's a multivalent question, because people live for economic reasons, people live on federal land right now, there just happens to be a very high rate of that. But then there's also people that choose very deliberately to keep a very small footprint on this planet and live remotely, but also very self-sufficiently. There's a whole branch of survivalism, which is related much more to a very huge sense of danger and determination to live isolated. In its robust forms, in the traditional like big nation buffet, there's lots of expressions of it, and this was inspired by two British. Some parts of this aspect of Ben's character were inspired by two beautiful documentaries, British documentaries in the mid '80s. One's available right now, right here on YouTube, and it described some soldiers that had lived in the Olympic Peninsula for many years. I was like, under